Well, I think at the early part, maybe Alabama was a little bit ahead of Auburn at that time. But then all of a sudden, Auburn started making some waves, and they had some good football teams. And that became important to Coach Bryant for that particular game. And he really put a premium on it. He really took them game by game. Tennessee, we got ready for a couple of weeks because of the single wing. The Auburn, because it was an in-state rivalry, and he felt like that that he needed to win that game, not only to, quote, keep everybody happy, but it always helped recruiting.
Well, when you think of Alabama football, you think of Coach Bryant. And the first thing that, you know, when people come over here, they see some of the paraphernalia about Coach Bryant. But it's really more than that. It goes before Coach Bryant, and it goes after Coach Bryant. And it's just, it's part of the history of the University of Alabama. And everybody, I guess, that comes in my office, I recommend that they come over to the museum. And there's another little plus. My little boy, John Mark, works over there, and I really enjoy and appreciate the museum.
December 3rd, 1948. Downtown Birmingham is packed with thousands of football fans. They're parading to celebrate a game that would, in the years ahead, become the game. The game in 1948 pitted Alabama's Crimson Tide against the Auburn Tigers. First time the two had played since 1941. Along 19th and 20th Streets, fans packed the sidewalks for this historic parade. Bama faithful cheered their band, marching behind a banner with the battle cry, "Tide Nips Tigers." Bama fans also got a glimpse of the wives of some of their stars, Mrs. Gordon Pettis, Mrs. Ray Richardson, and Mrs. Bill Cadenhead. Newspapers of December 48 tell us the fans of both schools partied all night long, getting ready for the first Bama-Auburn game since 1907. The next afternoon, 46,000 of those fans crowded into Legion Field. Their teams arrived soon after 1 for the 2 o'clock kickoff. Coach Harold Red-Drew and his Alabama staff came into the game a 2-touchdown favorite because of veteran stars like Pettis, Richardson, and Cadenhead. But they also had some sensational sophomores in Ed Salem, Al Larry, and Pat O'Sullivan. Auburn coach Earl Brown had his share of talent, too. And in the stands, his players could check out the Tigers' card section. Now, the game was a huge event, big enough for Governor Big Jim Folsom and his wife, movie star and former Bama player Johnny Mack Brown, and broadcaster Bill Stern, who was going nationwide on NBC Radio. When Captain Richardson for Bama met with Auburn's Russ Inman at midfield, everything was ready for the Tide of the Tigers in 1948, one of Bama's greatest games.
The Alabama Sports Network and the Paul W. Bryant Museum present Bama's Greatest Games.
Welcome to Bama's Greatest Games. I'm Tom Roberts with former Bama and pro quarterback Jeff Rutledge. And Jeff, it's hard to imagine that for better than 40 years, Alabama and Auburn didn't play football at all, considering the intensity of that rivalry today. When you were in school at Alabama, was it the game of the year?
It was the game of the year. And as we know, if you don't win that game as a player or a coach, you're in trouble. Because it's bragging rights for the state of Alabama. And for some reason, Auburn seems to rub it in a lot more than Alabama does when they win. But as a player, that was the game I look forward to most.
Was it a game that you prepared for more seriously than any other game on the schedule?
I don't think you prepared for it more seriously, but the media seemed to be around more during the week. You were interviewing all the time about what playing Auburn meant, the Iron Bowl. So it was constantly brought to your attention about what this week was all about. Now, you know, when I was in school, they were still playing the tape of the punt, Bama punt, and the block kicks, yeah. And that was the big thing that got Auburn fired up back then when I was playing, was that game. And you just knew you did not want to lose to Auburn.
Well, this particular game we're going to talk about on this show is a 1948 game. And it's the resumption of the rivalry. And it's an incredible football game, including Alabama blocking a punt for a touchdown. So it's some great starts. Let's go back to 1948, the first time the Tide and the Tigers have played in over 40 years. Here's the first quarter from Legion Field.
Bama wins the toss, so Bobby Weaver kicks it off for Auburn, and Bill Caton heads deep for the Tide. He takes it at the 10 and returns it 23 yards for Bama. The Tide lines up in the Notre Dame box, shifting for the first play. It's Gordon Pettis at left end. He gets nothing. Now it's Pettis trying the middle, 3 yards out to the 36. On third down, Pettis again. He gets six more, but a Bama penalty brings up fourth down. Now Jack Brown's injured and can't play quarterback, but he is able to punt. He kicks this one away, 48 yards to Travis Tidwell of the Tiger 21. He gets back only to the 25. Rebel Steiner makes the stop for Bama. This is going to be a day for turnovers, and Auburn makes the first mistake. Russell Inman fumbles in the first play. Herb Truckhanna recovers for Bama. For the fourth time in the first quarter, Pettis gets the ball for the Tide, and he picks up 5 to the Tiger 18. On second down, Pettis goes to the air trying to hit Steiner. It goes incomplete. Again, Pettis throws to Rebel. This time it's complete for 10 yards down to the Auburn 8. First and goal at the 8. Pettis tries right in. Auburn stops him for a loss of 1. But on second down, the Birmingham senior hits Butch Abinger at the 4. He's into the end zone. A 5-play drive for the touchdown. We get a second look from another film, this one in black and white. It's the same result, Pettis to Abinger, and Bama's up 6-0. Ed Salem kicks the extra point. Bama's on top by 7. And just check out the Legion Field scoreboard. Salem kicks it off for the Tide, and Tidwell gets it at the 10 for Auburn. Travis comes right back up the middle, met by Bama's Jim Franco, who drops him at the 29. Franco, by the way, broke his collarbone in the game. Now the Tigers try to pass. Tidwell drops back, gets a heavy rush from the middle, and it's just a long incompletion. Play, by the way, was wiped out by penalties on both teams. Gafford gets the call now right up the middle for 7 to the 36. The fumble came after the tackle by Elliott Speed and Pat O'Sullivan. Zach Jenkins on the sweep to the near side. He gets 1 to the 37. Fortunato on the tackle. Tigers have at least 2 strong arms in the backfield. This time it's Brownie Flournoy. He throws it long for Jim Pyburn, but Bama's there for the interception. Bill Catonhead makes the pick, and the Tide has it 1st and 10 at its own 27. On 1st down, Bama runs the sweep left. Red Noonan is dropped for no gain. This time, Noonan up the middle and gets 8 to the 35. On third down, Salem goes low to get a yard to the 36. Brown's on again to punt it away for Bama. A 44-yarder to Tidwell at his own 20. Jim Kane and Steve Fortunato are there to stop him at the 25. Tigers go with Tidwell on first down for 2 yards. Fortunato makes the stop. Gafford goes off right guard for 3 out to the 30. On third down, Tidwell gets the Tigers going. This pass good for 13 yards to Waddell. Catonhead drags him down at the 43. Gafford now at right tackle for 3 to the 46. Now Gafford wants to throw it for the Tigers, but Steiner separates him from the ball. It bounces upfield. Langner recovers for Auburn at the 45. On third down, Tidwell back to pass. Steiner and Bob Hood with a heavy rush. He gets it away to Gafford, who slips on the soggy turf and falls down at the 46. So Weaver's on to punt it away for Auburn. He kicks it out of bounds. It's marked at the Tide 20. Salem at the right side meets at Auburn. Stonewall, no gain. Noonan tries the left side and gets only a yard. Coach Drew and staff decide to punt it on third down. Brown kicks it away. 57 yards on the punt. Auburn's Jocko Norton takes it at the 24. He gets 8 yards before Bama runs him out of bounds. On first down, it's Floridoy on the end around. Brownie gets 3 yards before Herb Hanna blasts him down. Tidwell drops back to pass under a heavy rush from Bama. He throws short and incomplete. On third down, Tidwell tries again, and again, Alabama's there with a huge rush. Finally, Tidwell throws it long downfield. Nobody's there. It's incomplete. So Weaver kicks it away, and this time it goes out of bounds at the Bama 25. A 5-yard penalty puts it back at the 20, and Cadenhead tries left tackle but gets only a yard as the first quarter ends with Bama on top, 7-0.
Pretty clear after one quarter of this football game that Alabama is pretty well in control of it. Jeff, let's go back and look at the touchdown pass here. And Bama's running out of a Notre Dame box, but it almost looks like a shotgun.
It sure does. That would be what I would call it in today's terms. It's a shotgun and just hit the guy out in the flat.
Well, it was Gordon Pettis to Butch Abinger. We're going to see a replay of it here.
Well, they shifted ahead of time, which hopefully, you know, confuses the defense, and just overloaded one side and got the guy out.
Well, it was a good touchdown play. It gives Alabama the early lead. And it's Gordon Pettis is a guy who went on, and there are a lot of names that are going to become familiar to fans later on in another way. But Pettis became the head of the officials for the Southeastern Conference for years and years. One of the toughest jobs I think there is in all of sports.
I tell you what, I would not want to be a football official today.
Lots of speed. Well, Gordon Pettis was one of the guys, one of the stars of his 1948 Alabama-Auburn game. In years to come, it'll be known as the Iron Bowl, but in 48, it was a renewal of the Alabama-Auburn series. We have the second quarter coming up next.
Now a timeout on Bama's Greatest Games. In this timeout, let's look more closely at the Notre Dame box, the offensive formation used by the Tide and the Tigers in this game. A man familiar with the box is Clem Griska, who was on the 48 Bama team, later coach with Bear Bryant, and now is on the staff at the Bryant Museum.
Tom, perhaps some of the fans, or I guess you'd say, would think of it as a single wing, and it was a single wing as such, except we shifted on every play, and we were capable of shifting to the right or to the left. And in reality, there was three people in the backfield that could very easily have gotten the ball, from a real short plunge to the fullback on a reverse to the tailback or the left halfback to run or throw a ball.
You had a quarterback, but he really wasn't what we think of a quarterback now.
No, not really and truly. But you know what? I really enjoy that because I was fortunate. I accompanied the team to the last Rose Bowl game we went to, and then we had a big celebration in Birmingham for the 25th anniversary of the team that went to the Rose Bowl. And they gave us a plaque, and mine said quarterback. And I'd never touched a football during my career here at the university.
Well, the quarterback was actually more of a blocker.
Blocking back. What Coach Thomas used to say, you're nothing but a glorified guard, because the two guards were pulling on most of the plays, and the quarterback accompanied them. And sometimes we'd get a two-on-one block with the quarterback and the guards.
And you're talking about Coach Thomas. Did he bring the box from Notre Dame?
He played at Notre Dame, and of course he was a real close friend of Coach Rockne's, and yes, he did, because the Notre Dame box originated at Notre Dame, and as a matter of fact, I think they used to have a piano player or something to teach him how to do the crossover, the shifting part of it. And the unique thing about that comparatively, at least Coach Thomas had us believing that we were better than Tennessee in regard that we could go right or left, where Tennessee was kind of handicapped, not handicapped, they're stereotyped. If they had the formation right, that is the way they'd go.
...1948, Alabama against Auburn, one of Bama's greatest games. And Jeff Rutledge in this one, both teams using the Notre Dame box. Now, neither one of us was in a position, you weren't around at all. I was 2 years old when this game was played. So the Notre Dame box is not something we know a lot about. However, it reminds me, there at the in the first quarter, kind of a shotgun formation for the touchdown, it reminds you of a lot of different offenses.
It does. You could say shotgun. You could also say wishbone because of all the ball handling that's going on and the shifting. Could be pro-type offense in today's terms, how they give teams different looks.
Yeah.
Look complicated to me.
Looks very complicated. It's being used on both sides, but right now Bama is getting the better of the formation as we go to the second quarter of the 1948 Auburn game.
Starting the second quarter, Salem looks to pitch on the sweep right, but keeps it himself and gets 3 to 24. On third down, Jack Brown up the middle for 5 yards. Not quite enough for the first down. So Brown has to kick it again, this time for 49 yards to Norton at the Tiger 23. Al DiOrio forces him out of bounds at the 31. Penalty cost Auburn 5 yards, so it's first and 15 from the 26. And it's Flournoy ripping off left tackle. He races away for 10 yards before Mike Mizrani knocks him down for Bama. Bill Ferris stops the Tigers for nothing from the 36. Now Tidwell fakes a pass to the left, goes right up the middle for 7 yards and a first down. Speed on the tackle at the 43. Flournoy takes it off left guard, 3 yards before Walter May knocks him down. So from the 46, Weaver has to punt again. He kicks it 43 yards to Bama's Salem. And Ed shows us his speed, racing it back 23 yards to the tied 33. However, a clipping penalty set Bama back to its own 11. Now let's go back to the black and white film. Clem Welch gets Bama out of the hole quickly, taking the pitch. Welch got a great block from Avenger. He rambles 33 yards, and the Tide has it first and 10 at the 44. Salem goes to the air now, 6 yards to Jim Kane at the 50. Salem carries it himself on second down, gets by one tackler and to the Auburn 45. First down now, Tigers put a strong rush on Salem. He yields ground, but gets his pass away to Tom Calvin. He rambles all the way to the Auburn 32. This time, Salem just tosses it to Calvin. He eats up 8 yards to the 24. Again, it's Calvin right up the middle to a first down at the Tigers 20. Now Salem wants a touchdown, but his pass deep goes over the head of his intended receiver. All-American won't be denied, though. Salem fires this one 20 yards to a wide-open Welch for Bama's second touchdown. Salem adds the extra point, and the Tide's up 14-0. Back to color film now as Salem kicks off to Auburn's Jenkins. He can't find the handle, and a bunch of Tide tacklers drop him at the 15. On first down, Inman gets 5 yards up the middle, but the Tigers are offside. So from the 10, Norton tries right in, but Jack Smith and O'Sullivan are there to make the stop for Bama. The play makes 3. Now it's Norton up the middle. The Tide stops him at the 17. So it looks like an Auburn punt on third down. But Weaver throws the ball instead to Inman. Ed Holnick stops him short of the first down. This time Weaver does kick it. Pettis takes it for the Tide at his own 25. And Gordon gets 7 yards out to the 32. On first down, Tom Calvin, the direct snap. He picks up 3. Tide gets another 15 and an Auburn personal foul, so it's first down at midfield. Welch shows us his speed at left end, racing 9 yards to the Auburn 41. Next, Calvin tries the middle and gets a yard at the most. Now it's Welch again, this time on the receiving end of a Salem pass, and Bama has it at the Auburn 31. Back on the ground, Calvin gets 4 tough yards to the Tiger 27. Auburn puts a heavy rush on Salem, but he lets it fly, looping downfield. It's caught by Avenger. Great catch between two Auburn defenders at the Tiger 15. Let's take a closer look in black and white as Salem makes a great throw and Avenger a very tough catch. After a 5-yard penalty back to the 20, Bama goes to the air again. Salem finds Ralph Cochran wide open on the right side. He takes it all the way to the Auburn 6. Now check the blocking as the entire line pulls this way. Welch takes it in for Bama's third touchdown of the afternoon. The black and white replay shows us that Avenger also laid a good block to get Welsh into the end zone. Salem again adds the extra point, and Bama's on top 21-0. For the third time, Auburn gets the kickoff, and Russell takes it at the 20. He gets 10 before Fortunato and Cadenhead bring him down. The Tigers have to pass now. Inman hits Waddell for 8. It's Pettis who stops him at the 39. Inman to the air again, but this time Billy Ball can't handle it. One more time, Inman tries to air it out, but overshoots Flournoy. Now the Tigers come up with a big play. Ball drops back to pass. It's Inman on the near sideline. He gets 18 yards to the tied 44. Auburn's in Bama territory for the first time. But Al Larry takes care of that. He breaks through to sack Flournoy for a loss of 15. Pelfrey takes the toss and heads right, but he slips down at the 43. Again on third down, Weaver back in punt formation. Again, he tries to pass, but it's incomplete. Now the final play of the first half. Pelfrey wants to throw, but sack man Al Larry's there again to drop him for a 10-yard loss. Bama goes to the locker room. Band tells the story. The Tide's on top, 21-0.
In the second quarter, Bama really in control, and one of the big reasons is Ed Salem. I was really impressed in watching this tape. Ed Salem was truly became an All-American, but a great, great back.
He was a great back. I remember my dad talking about him, you know, as I was growing up, about Ed Salem and him playing with Ed Salem at one time. And neat to watch these films and seeing these old guys and names that, like you said, I wasn't even around then.
Well, let's watch a replay of one of the touchdown passes that he threw in this football game. This one's going to Clem Welsh. He sails it down
great
to the end
throw,
zone.
Great throw, great route. Just got behind the defensive back, but...
Well, it's a game in which Salem, and he was called Big Shoe. I guess that's one of the reasons there, because he kicked 7 extra points in this football game. But he threw 2 touchdown passes. Also ran in one from 17 yards out. Wound up with 60 points on the season, unheard of. But something here, and it's the first game Alabama's played against Auburn in years, but it's still a big rival. Is it easier to get up and play a big game against the big rival?
It is. I know as a player myself, Auburn was the game I got up for him probably more than any other game. And for some reason, players tend to play better against certain teams. You know, I seem to play better against Auburn than other teams. I don't know why that was. But, you know, Ed Salem, who knows what he was thinking at this time, but obviously he went in there and had a big game. And you called him Bigfoot as I was watching the tape. Big Shoe.
Yeah.
I noticed it taking a shoe off after he kicked. So maybe he wore a different size shoe when he kicked the extra points and field goals.
Well, whatever. Big Shoe is the big reason Bama had the lead over Auburn. As we go to intermission, we're going to look at part of the Alabama Band's halftime show from 1948 with music provided by the current edition of the Million Dollar Band.
Timeout on Bama's Greatest Games. In this timeout, the coach of the 48 Bama team, Harold Red Drew. Coach Drew led the Tide from 1947 to 1954. His teams won 55 games, an SEC championship, and 3 bowl trips. One of his former players, Clem Griska, remembers Coach Drew.
Coach Drew, of course, was here for a while, and then he got the Ole Miss job in Oxford as a head coach. And then Coach Thomas brought him back in 1945 as one of his assistant coaches, and he worked with the ends offensively and defensively. Very, very strategic, and the big thing about him that Coach Thomas used to always say, that he was an excellent scout.
Was Drew a real loud, wild, crazy type, or more of a laid-back, very serious type?
Very, very quiet and very serious. He was originally from Maine, but he fit right in with the Alabama program here. And very, very quiet, and let the assistants do an awful lot of the work.
We're headed to the second half of the 1948 game between Alabama and Auburn. At halftime, Bama's up 21-0, and I would have an idea in the locker room they were talking a lot about don't get overconfident. But how the heck do you guard against that, Jeff?
Well, when you're playing Auburn, I think that's probably what they were saying is, hey, it's Auburn. We hadn't played them in a while. Let's not get overconfident. Let's go out, keep doing what we're doing, and things should take care of themselves.
Well, they definitely do that in the third quarter of this one. Not overconfident, but definitely in control. That's the story for the Tide as we go into the third quarter of a 1948 game against the Auburn Tigers.
Bama starts the second half, kicking off to Auburn, and the Tide gets another break immediately. Pelfrey takes a kick in the end zone, streaking downfield for Bama. Holnack, who strips the ball away. Steiner recovers. Tide's in business at the Tiger 19. On first down, Salem gets 3 yards right up the middle. And now it's Salem around right end. He's going to go all the way for the touchdown. Check the replay as Salem moves to the far side. Holnack and Avenger throw key blocks, and Ed streaks to the end zone. Birmingham sophomore adds the extra point. It's Alabama 28, Auburn nothing. On the ensuing kickoff, Gafford plays it smart for Auburn, stays in the end zone. Tigers get it at their own 20. On first down, Billy Ball takes it for 4 at right end. The Tigers are offside, though, and it's back to the 15. Replaying the down, Flournoy loses 5 more as Mizrani and Speed dropping back at the 10. Gafford gets the call. He gets 3 at left guard. Third down, Billy Ball tries the other side and knifes his way for 7 yards, but he's short of the first down. Weaver avoids a big Tide rush and gets his punt away. It rolls dead at the Bama 40-yard line. Tiger defenders are fired up at this point. Look at them stop Salem for no gain on first down. On second, Tide sweeps left. Look at the blocking in front of Bill Abston. He gets 6 on his first carry of the day. That brings up third down, and Salem goes to the air to his favorite target, Steiner. Rebel breaks free from 2 Auburn tacklers and races to the end zone. Longest play of the day deserves a second look. Look at Steiner break those tackles, and then show us his speed, 53 yards in all, 4 of a touchdown. On the extra point, snaps low, but Brown gets it in place. Salem kicks it through. It's Bama 35, Auburn nothing. The busy Salem kicks it off again. Billy Ball takes it in the end zone and gets to the 10, where he's met by a host of Bama tacklers. On first down from the 10, Ball tries the middle, gets 3. Miller on the stop. Gafford gets 3 more for the Tigers. Out to the 16, tackled by O'Sullivan. After a series of penalties, it's still at the 16, and Inman's looking to throw. But Larry Lauer's there for the Tide. He intercepts, and Bama's deep in Tiger territory again at the 24. Calvin tries right in. He gets it down to the 20. Now it's Bob Cochran up the middle. He gets 6 more, and Bama's close to a first down inside the Auburn 15. That's as close as the Tide can get, because on third down, Tigers blast through to drop Calvin for a loss at the 20. And on fourth down, they stop the Athens sophomore again, so Auburn stops the Bama drive, takes over at its own 17. On first down, Tigers sweep right, Norton with the ball, but Larry and DiOrio break through the blocking to knock him down. Auburn stays inside. Jenkins fights his way out to the 20. Shifting around, the Tigers try to cross Bama up. They fake right, go left, but they can't fool Haushalter. He's there to make the tackle. Weaver's on to punt again. His teammates provide great coverage, and Bama helps out with a clipping penalty. Walk-off puts the Tide back at its own 21. On first down, Bob Cochran on the sweep right. He gets nothing. Next, the sweep to the near side, and Charlie Davis picks up 10, but another penalty on Bama. This time, a personal foul, and the Tide is back at its own 8. Coach Drew decides to kick it out of the end zone. Brown punts it away to Norton at the 48. Jocko gets it to the 43. Ed White on the stop. First down, Gafford back to pass. Good rush for Bama. Good coverage downfield. 2 defenders break it up. Second down, Jenkins rolls out around left end. Cochran and Lauer are there to knock him out of bounds at the 40. Now here comes Billy Ball behind three blockers, but look at Tom Calvin break through all of them and knock him down at the 45. Tigers are stopped one more time. Weaver punts it again. This time out of bounds, it's marked at the Bama 16. On black and white film, look at Ralph Cochran get loose for the longest run of a day. He races around right end, 46 yards in all, down to the Auburn 38. This time, though, Cochran slips down as he tries to go around right end. Then his brother Bob tries to go to the air. He fires this one long, only to see Johnny Wallace intercept it and return all the way to the 50 as the third quarter ends. Still, Bama's on top, 35-0 with 15 minutes to go.
After three quarters, Alabama's completely in charge of its 1948 Alabama-Auburn game, and one of the reasons why is this play. Ed Salem's done a good job all afternoon long, but look at the catch by Rebel Steiner and the run.
Just ran over two guys and then made the third guy miss and then outran everybody to the end zone. Just a great throw and great run after the catch.
It's Salem who had, we've already talked about, had a great day, but Steiner on this one makes the day. And as far as I'm concerned, the play of the game here.
Oh, definitely. You won't find a better run than that after a catch, ever.
And he's going to wind up in that great-looking end zone.
Oh, I love that checkerboard end zone. I remember that as a kid going to the Alabama game, seeing that.
Well, as a kid, you were fortunate to grow up in the Birmingham area and play high school football at Legion Field, so it's home, isn't it?
It is home, and it was a great thrill as a high school kid to be able to go into that stadium knowing that Alabama was going to turn around the next day and play on that field.
Well, and I think there are some people who would say that Alabama should play all of its home games in Tuscaloosa, but there have been some great ones at Legion Field in Birmingham. Well, this is a pretty good one here.
Definitely.
Rebel Steiner makes the great run. He may not rank all that highly among great receivers at Alabama, but only because there have been some tremendous ones. Your recollections as a quarterback, I would think, after the offensive line, receivers are maybe your second favorite subject.
Definitely. And when I was playing, Ozzie Newsome's got to be the first name you come to, because he was a great, great receiver. And unfortunately, he played on a wishbone team that didn't take advantage of what he could do. And I don't think until he got to the pro ranks were you able to see what Ozzie Newsome could do.
Well, kind of the prototype of what a tight end should be.
Great, but he played wide receiver here. I mean, we would split him out wide, but he was still fast enough and big enough, and as a quarterback, you would just throw the ball up, and he'd catch it.
You knew he was going to catch it. Some others that you played with or remember from Alabama football history.
Well, my roommate was a great receiver, I thought, didn't get to play that much, but Keith Pugh. I loved to throw to him, and he could run after he caught it and make some great moves. And Bruce Bolton, I remember, made a big catch in a Sugar Bowl game I played in. And then you got to look back at Dennis Holman and Ray Perkins and those guys. Joey Jones comes to mind, little speedster. Just some great receivers.
Well, and Jesse Bendros is another one that comes to mind from some years later during the 80s. Well, we're going to have some more good passing and catching. Stay with us. The fourth quarter of the 1948 Auburn game is coming up next.
Now a timeout on Bama's greatest games. In this timeout, the star of the 48 Auburn game for Alabama, that was definitely Ed Salem. The Birmingham native would go on to become an All-American in 1950, and his teammate, Clem Griska, tells us quickly that Salem was a great one.
Ed Salem was the cliche, they say, a triple threat man. Of course, Eddie could punt, he could place kick, he could pass, and he could run. And he had an awful lot of speed, a lot of quickness for that era back then. Time-wise, I'm not real sure how fast he ran, but he was faster than most of the ones on the opposing team.
Well, now, he was not a quarterback in the box, at least, but really was more like I would think a quarterback is nowadays.
I'd say he handled the ball probably 99% of the time. If he got the ball, either he was running, handing it to the fullback or the right halfback, or throwing a pass. And he was the quarterback of the Notre Dame box.
As we go into the fourth quarter of a 1948 Auburn game, it seems that Alabama scored about every way you can, Jeff, but a couple of surprises coming here in the fourth, breaks that you have to win a football game.
Well, you need to block some kicks. Let's just ask Auburn on the other end.
That's right.
More current, but Alabama came up with a couple big plays on special teams.
And defense is going to hopefully get you a turnover, and here in the fourth quarter it's going to be turned into a touchdown with an interception. So let's get to the fourth quarter. Back to Legion Field, 1948, Alabama and Auburn.
Bama's defense continues to hammer away as we start the fourth quarter. Al Theris breaks through the blocking to drop Auburn for an 8-yard loss back to the 42. On second down, defense stays in the Tigers. Pelfrey back to pass, chased, has to run, and only gets back to the line of scrimmage. Al Larry with a punishing tackle. Tigers try to pass again. This time it's picked off by Bama's Roy Smalley. With some nifty moves, he runs it back 25, all the way to the Auburn 33. On first down, Bob Cochran has to fight his way back to the line of scrimmage. Second down try at right guard manages only a yard. Possession play, reserve halfback Don Sporrell's on. He sets sail around left end for 10 yards and a first down. This time it's Welsh to the near side. He picks up a couple. From the 21, a heavy rush from the Tigers forcing Salem back. Finally loops one downfield, but Auburn's Gafford's there to intercept at the 10 and get it back out to the 15. Gafford also with the first crack on offense, ripping the middle for 5 yards. Second down, Tidwell back to pass. Ralph Cochran tips it away. After another loss, the Tigers have to punt it. Weaver from the goal line. Ball's going to roll dead at the 45, and once again, Bama has great field position. On first down, Bob Cochran hauls it around right end, gets 10 yards to the Tigers' 35. Now it's Ralph Cochran. He goes to the air, hitting Ed White. He picks up 15, going inside the 20-yard line. From there, Cochran wants the touchdown and tries to connect with Howard Pearson, but two Auburn defenders knock it down in the end zone. Another penalty against the Tide, 15 yards back to the 35, and Bama tries to go long again, this time overthrowing everybody. One play later, Cochran decides to punt. It goes into the end zone, but a penalty against Auburn gives Bama first and 10 at the Tigers' 20. Tide tries on the ground now, 3 yards to the 17. Another reserve halfback, Jim Burkett, is knocked down for a 3-yard loss. So from just outside the 20, Bama goes with the end around. Al Larry races around right end, makes a great run down to the Auburn 1-yard line. Again, though, a flag flies, and the play is brought back. Personal foul costs Bama 10 to the 30. So Bob Cochran decides to try Pearson again. This time, the combo works for 30 yards and a touchdown. Second look shows Cochran getting great protection from his offensive line and Pearson beating the defenders in the end zone. After Salem kicks the extra point, Bama's way out in front, 42 to nothing, and it's getting dark here in Birmingham. Alabama's kickoff this time goes to Arnold Fagan, but he gets only 8 yards to the 30. Auburn has to throw, and the first down pass goes incomplete. There's nothing on second down as the left side of Bama's defense stops them cold. On third down, Edmond tries a dangerous pass, actually a lateral. Luckily for Auburn, it's out of bounds. Now as Auburn tries to kick, Lauer breaks through to block it. Tom Selman, Roy Smalley, and Walter May chase it to the end zone. All three of them fall on it for another Tide touchdown. Who else but Salem kicks the extra point. It's now 49 to nothing. Again, Bama kicks off, and the Tide coverage is great, stopping Auburn at the 18. From there, another turnover. Falls back to pass, flips it out into the flat. Don Spurl picks it off at the 21, and he goes all the way for the touchdown. A replay shows that Spurl, a New York sophomore, just timed his break perfectly for the Tide's 8th touchdown. Salem's string of extra points finally broken as Auburn blocks it, but Bama now has a 55-point advantage. On this kickoff, Tigers do a little better. They get it back to their own 23. You can see the fans starting to leave the stadium, but Auburn's not leaving. Tigers still trying. Gafford throws upfield, but Cochran knocks it down. Gafford wants to pass again, but Bama pressure forces him to run, slips and falls on the last play of the game. So the first game in the renewed rivalry goes to the Crimson Tide. The final, Alabama 55, Auburn nothing.
Now a timeout on Bama's greatest games. In this final timeout, let's talk about playing Auburn. For the Tide in 1948, the Auburn game wasn't that big of a deal. Certainly not what the annual game of the Tigers would become. Just listen to Clem Griska.
Tom, that was the other university in the state. And at that time, they were the Alabama Polytech Institute. They weren't on our schedule. They were across the state. And in other words, they were not one of our rivals or one of our big games or anything. And after 40-some years resuming the relationship, we didn't really understand what it was. And at that time, they weren't playing real well. And we'd just come off an undefeated season and then a very, very good season in 46 and 7. So it was just another game at that time.
Did you ever envision, and you were there then and you're here now, did you ever envision it would be the rivalry it is today?
I certainly didn't, because they had so many youngsters from out of state, where a lot of ours were in-state youngsters. And of course, we had some out-of-staters too. But no, we didn't think the rivalry would get this great.
Through the 50s and the 60s, the Auburn game became as intense as it is now. And it's still especially important for players from the state of Alabama. For example, a star of the 60s, Tommy Brooker, who hailed from Demopolis.
Well, I think any time you beat Auburn, and my group was fortunate enough to beat them three times in a row, 10-0, 3-0, and then 34-0. Anytime you can beat Auburn 3 years in a row, in anything, whatever it might be. Coach Bryant had instilled in us that was the game that we had to have. And because of bragging rights, because of being, you know, from Alabama, living in Alabama, that you had to also, he taught us too, we had to face our mamas and daddies and the little kids, and your little kid one of these days is gonna say, "Daddy, how come you didn't beat Auburn?" He said, "It's entirely up to you to tell them why." And you think about that real hard. It's difficult. You know, what are you going to tell them? I got hurt.
Alabama 55, Auburn nothing, has a nice ring to it, doesn't it?
It sure does.
1948, renewal of a series. Let's take a look at the highlights of this one. It's somewhat the Ed Salem show, although Gordon Pettis on this first touchdown pass to Butch Avenger. Bama kept scoring early and often. Salem to Clem Welsh in the end zone.
Just wide open behind the defensive back. How do you like that number 82 as the defensive back?
Well, on this one, it's going to be a rollout around left end and tremendous blocking.
You got to have that blocking to be able to score, especially when you're going to go wide.
Welsh got the touchdown there, and now Ed Salem, who passed for two, is going to run for one.
I tell you what, it's hard to figure out who's got the ball in that offense.
Notre Dame box is one of those just tricks, folks. Here's our favorite play of the game. Salem to Rebel Steiner, 53 yards for the touchdown.
I love it to see a receiver do that. Nowadays, you don't see a lot of receivers that'll lower their head and run over guys.
And he flat did there. Other guys get in on the scoring. Bob Cochran going 30 yards to Pearson for this touchdown. Actually, they tried that play a couple of plays earlier, and it didn't work. Now, block punt.
Yes.
Larry Lauer does it for Alabama, and three Tide players recover it in the end zone for a touchdown. And the final score of the day, Don Spurl, playing in his first game ever, intercepts the pass. He broke on it just right. Bama's eighth touchdown of the game. They blocked the extra point there, but that's about the only downside for the day. Ed Salem finishes with seven extra points, 55-0. As I said, it has a nice ring.
It sure does.
Well, it's a great game because of the nature of it. It's the renewal of the Alabama-Auburn series, 1948. A couple of other notes in the game. Al Larry, defensive star in this one, had a couple of sacks. His brother Frank later became the Yankee killer, pitching for the Detroit Tigers. And, of course, Ed Salem went on to become an All-American in 1950 for Alabama. Alabama and Auburn, you win. It's a great game, right?
You're right, Tom.
That's exactly the reason we've got 1948, Alabama over Auburn, one of Bama's greatest games.
You can see all of Bama's greatest games at the Paul W. Bryant Museum on the University of Alabama campus. The museum's chock full of memories for Bama fans, from the early years of Tide football through the Rose Bowl under Coach Frank Thomas. You can relive Bama's greatest wins. And as Museum Director Ken Gaddy says, you can take a journey in time.
Well, what people find is that they find places in time that they fit into. So people that went to school here in the 30s or spend more time with the 30s, and the people that went here in the 60s and 70s will find their place.
Among those places in time, the years that Bama won national titles under Paul Bear Bryant, you can see his office and his houndstooth hat. Coach Bryant's players have featured prominently too, including those who went on to make their mark in the pros. And of course, you can relive the memories of Bama's most recent national champions, Gene Stallings' 1992 Crimson Tide. So stop by and visit the Bryant Museum on the University of Alabama campus. And join us next time for more of Bama's greatest games.